Thank you. So indeed, in this paper with Francis Bach, we were interested into the problem of the optimization of a convex function f on a constraint set x. But the issue we had is, so when we make the sequential query x1, x2, up to xt, is that the feedback we have is not the gradient of f or the Hessian of f, but only the value of f of xi plus some noise. So this is similar to the convex bandit scenario. So we don't have really any practical algorithm to solve that issue, that problem. So what we aim at is mimicking the gradient descent. So what should we do that? Because we know that if we're taking the gradient descent and we have some mild assumption of f, the optimization error will decrease in 1 over square root of t. But more importantly, if you had the assumption on f, such as the smoothness, these rates of convergence are much faster. And actually, which is even more important in gradient descent, is that the smoother the function is, the faster it is. And we kind of have the same property with strong convexity. So our question was, can we do the same thing in zero order optimization? Can we leverage the fact that the functions we consider are really, really smooth? Not just smooth, but really smooth. So just to remind you a few definitions, we say that f is strongly convex if its second derivative is lower bounded, and smooth if the second derivative is upper bounded. And in this talk, actually in this paper, we will consider not only smooth function, but really, really smooth function. And what I mean by that is that not only the second derivative is bounded, but its beta derivative, are also bounded. And this is on a crucial assumption. It gives us the fact that f is more or less equal to its Taylor expansion up to the power of beta minus 1. So now the question we were wondering is, can we, and how can we leverage the fact that we know that f is really, really smooth to optimize it in this zero-order feedback. But first of all, since we have some noise, we will never be able to mimic a gradient descent. The only thing we can do is mimic stochastic gradient descent. And there is some theoretical work on stochastic gradient descent, and we know that the rates of convergence are no longer square root of t and 1 over mu t, but it becomes square root of d over t and d over mu t. So here, the message of that slide is if you're going to do stochastic gradient descent, so if you have a noise in your data, then you will lose a factor d in your rates of convergence. But still, this doesn't say how can we mimic a stochastic gradient descent based solely on value evaluation of f. So there is a way to do that, actually, which is, let's say, due to Yudin and Mirovsky, and it's pretty simple in one dimension. In one dimension, we all know that f prime of x is more or less equal to the difference between f of x plus delta and f of x minus delta divided by 2 delta. That's the basic definition of the derivative. But more importantly, that difference, which is almost the gradient of f, is exactly the gradient of a function which is almost f. And that function is defined by the expectation over the unit ball of f of x plus delta v. And this function, so it has an explicit gradient that can be estimated because its gradient is only the definition of its gradient is only based on the value of f, not the gradient of f, only the value of f. So I can build an estimate of that, the gradient of that function, and this gradient will have a small variance of the order 1 over delta square. So now if I do a stochastic gradient descent with respect to my approximated function, what will I get? I will get a rate of convergence for that estimated function, approximated function, on 1 over delta square root of t. And so the optimization error of f, if I use that algorithm, is going to be the sum of the estimation error, 1 over delta square root of t, plus the approximation error between f delta and f, which is delta. And so at the end, if you pick the right delta, you will end up with a rate of convergence of 1 over t to the 1/4. So the good thing about this idea of Nemirovsky and Yudin is that it extends in higher dimension, let's say in dimension d. But in dimension d, you won't need only one difference to get the gradient. You will need d differences, one per dimension. So the first message of that slide is when you go to first order method to zero order method, you will lose, well, we expect that we will lose another factor d. And more importantly, the idea we had in dimension one works in dimension d. If we define the same function, approximation function f delta to be the expectation of f of x plus delta v over the unit ball, that function is a delta approximation of f, and it has an explicit gradient that depends only on the value of f. So I can estimate it pretty easily. And my estimate is going to have a variance that scales as d square over delta square. So now if I do the same idea, stochastic gradient descent on my approximated function, the optimization error will be, again, the sum of the estimation error, d over delta square root of t, plus the approximation error delta. And pick the right delta, and you get this rate of convergence. So, yeah. So now the question is, what were we aiming at? What are our objectives? So we, if we had access to deterministic gradient descent, we knew that we could optimize it as square root of 1 over t or 1 over mu t, depending on the function is strongly convex or not. We're going to add some stochasticity, some noise, so we will lose the factor d. We're going to consider zero third order method, so we expect to lose another factor d. So at the end, we were hoping to build an algorithm such that the optimization error scale as square root of d square over t or d square over mu t. So unfortunately, we did not manage to do that, mostly because it's impossible. But what we managed to do is to get those rates of convergence up to an exponent that depends on the smoothness parameter, and when beta goes to 1, this smoothness parameter goes to 1. So if the function is infinitely smooth, say, for instance, if it's a quadratic loss, or if it's a logistic regression, then we will recover those results. Now the question is, you might ask, is how can we leverage the fact that the function is smooth? And actually, this is an idea of Poyak and Sibakov. And to say that if f is smooth, then you can expand it locally around some point x. And so you expand it, and you see that I'm using the Taylor expansion. And now when you have this inequality here, which is only the Taylor expansion, you can see that if you integrate it against some kernel that satisfies those properties, you can build a new function, that one, the one on the left, which is an approximation of f. But this new function is not a delta approximation of f, it's a delta to the beta approximation of f. So I've just built a very, very good approximation of f. And now our idea was to say, okay, we have those two ideas, let's combine them. And we define a new function, new approximation function, which is going to be the expectation of f of x plus delta r delta v on the unit ball, integrated against the kernel that we defined before. And that function here is going to be a delta to the beta approximation of f, so it's very good approximation of f, and its gradient is as an explicit form and depends only on the value of f. So I can estimate it in my zeroth order feedback. And I can also control the variance of that estimate. And something which is also crucial is that the gradient we obtain here is a very good approximation of the gradient of f, up to the delta to the beta minus 1. So now the idea we might have is, okay, so we have a function which is almost f, which is BS nicely, so I might want to do a stochastic gradient descent with respect to that function. And actually, that's what we did. So our algorithm is just do a stochastic gradient descent with respect to that new function. And if x is compact, it's exactly that. If x is not compact, then we're doing a two-step procedure just to kill the intercept. But that's minor detail. So how can this give us the results I gave you? So it's pretty simple if you look at the proof. Well, the optimization error of f is still going to be the sum of the approximation and the estimation error. The estimation error, if let's say f is mu strongly convex, is still 1 over mu t times the variance, so d square over delta square. The approximation error is not delta to the beta minus 1. So my error, more or less, let's say, to simplify things, is going to be the sum of both terms. Pick the right delta, and you get the rights I claimed. And that's how we get all those rights. So now, when we look at this, we might say, well, this is impossible, actually, because this contradicts non-lower bounds. Indeed, there are lower bounds that say that even if you have, if you consider a mu strongly convex function, there always exists a function, no matter your algorithm, such that the error is scaled as 1 over square root of t. And as you can see, we get an error of 1 over t. But actually, it's not a contradiction, because the lower bound holds for non-highly smooth function, not all the smooth function. Not necessarily the functions that are highly smooth. So if you consider only the functions that are highly smooth, we can get a lower bound that scale actually as exactly as that matches our upper bound asymptotically, only asymptotically. So we are not contradicting any non-lower bounds, which is a good thing. And the last remark I want to do on that problem is that actually everything I said before in this talk works in when you're doing online optimization, so when the function f changes at all stages and you kind of minimize some regret, but it's not working for exactly for the bounded setting. And I guess I will conclude on that sentence.